be reading these words of Paul that come in the fourth chapter of that letter. That's the second half of verse 11 and verse 12. Hear now the word of God as it comes to us from the pen of the Apostle Paul. I have learned to be content with whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well-fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. What remarkable words to our generation. I have learned the secret of being content, whether well-fed or in need. With all that we have in our culture, you would think that we would be happy, but instead the reality is we think we would be happier if we had more stuff. You know, it's not enough to have a car. We're told that we need to have this particular car. And we look at that car on the commercials and we think, man, that is a nice ride. And you know, we think, wouldn't I look good in that car? Because the guy driving that car looks good. You would think he was a model or something. Because he's a model. You think, man, I would look just as good as that. I need that car. We think that stuff is going to make us happier. We're marketed this way. You know, your children will be happier if you go to McDonald's and purchase for them the Happy Meal. Has anyone found this to be the case? Do your children have more lasting happiness? How many of those meals do they have to consume to really be happy? You know, we think, if only I had this thing or that thing. And part of that sometimes for us is because we feel this pressure to keep up with the neighbors. I read recently that if someone in your neighborhood wins the lottery, their neighbors are more likely to go bankrupt than the general population. Why is that? Well, somebody wins the lottery, they're going to buy some new, nice stuff. So the people living around them are going to think, man, I ought to have some new, nice stuff as well. And they end up having to declare. Often, also, does the lottery winner themselves. Yeah, to quote, this quote comes from Dave Ramsey of Financial Peace University fame. He says, we buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't like. My wife Jill took on a project. This warms the heart of every insurance agent and insurance company. After we moved to Stewart, she went through our house and videoed the contents of the house, all of our possessions. And of course, this is so if something happens and you need to make a claim, you can substantiate that you actually did have this or that. We have a lot of stuff, as it turns out. I know because I took that show on about 4 or 5 years ago. I produced a one-hour video, the most boring thing in the world. Would you like to see it? I wouldn't do that to you. But, you know, it just brought home how much stuff we have. I think if while we were at church, our house burned, what would I truly miss? Now, it would be inconvenient. But what there would I really miss? There are a few things. Heirlooms, you know, things that made for us or that were passed down to us. There's a few of those. The photo albums, which I really should scan or take digital pictures of those things. And because my kids are in the service, the pets, the family pet. No, I love the family pets too. We would save the cats and the fish if we'd miss them if they were gone. But you know, most of that stuff is just stuff. Just stuff. That stuff is temporary. The people who live in the house, they are forever. But the stuff is just temporary. Jesus says this in Luke's Gospel, chapter 12. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. I'll read that to you again. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Commercials, advertisers tell us that Jesus has got this wrong. Right? Because they want us to believe that, no, our life does consist in the abundance of possessions, and that's why we need to buy whatever it is they're selling. But in truth, the advertisements are wrong, and Jesus is right. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Have you ever heard of this physical ailment called RLS, Restless Leg Syndrome? This is a real thing. If you have RLS, Restless Leg Syndrome, your legs will twitch at night, sometimes to the point of waking you up from sleep. Adam Hamilton wrote a book a few years ago. It's a great little book called Enough. He titled this, Enough, Discovering Joy Through Simplicity and Generosity. And in the book, he says that many of us are afflicted with RHS, Restless Heart Syndrome. And the primary symptom of RHS, Restless Heart Syndrome, is discontent. Discontent. We have stuff, but we want new stuff. Or we want more stuff. And it doesn't just end with material possessions. You may have a job, but you decide, well, I would like a new job. I would like a better job. I would like a job with the perfect boss and an awesome work environment. I would like the job with better pay and a shorter commute. So I need a new job. Sometimes we even do this in church world. Well, I thought that church was great when I started going there, but now I'm thinking, messages are not connecting that well with me, and gosh, that one person hurt my feelings, and I volunteered, and nobody followed up on it, so I think I'm going to shop for another church. Sometimes we even do this with spouses. We have restless heart syndrome. Now, the good news is there is therapy for RHS. In this book, Enough, the author, Adam Hamilton, shares in one of the chapters things we can do to cultivate contentment. And these are all listed in your bulletin. Just kind of work our way through this list. The first one, remember, it could be worse. You know, oftentimes we'll look at something we own and we'll think, you know, this thing, I can look at my car this way. I'm driving a 1999 Nissan Altima, car of the last millennium. And it's a good car, but I'll tell you, I can focus on what's not right with it. One of the things not right with it, the driver's side sunvisor broke several years ago, and I went to the junkyard and I got one off of Maxima. It's a bigger car. So I have a hybrid now. Right, all a little bit of Maxima. Well, the thing is, the hardware fit, but the Maxima is a bigger car, so the sunvisor is about this much too long. It doesn't lock in place, and it is a different color than the interior of my car. So I could, every time I get in that car, I could look at it and say, oh man, this car just stinks because it's got the wrong sunvisor in it. Or I could consider what is right about the car, what's good about the car. Hey, the car has got a sunroof that works. That's pretty cool. I like having a sunroof. And the car does run well. You know, so we ought to focus on what's good and, you know, let what's not perfect recede into the background. Number two, ask yourself, how long will this thing that I'm thinking about buying, how long will this make me happy? Where we used to have in our household two guinea pigs. And we would go to the pet store and just look around at all the animals and things. And sometimes my kids would see something that they'd like to get for the guinea pigs, like a little wood chew block or something, which, you know, that's good for them. Well, this one time, we came across the guinea pig jogging vest. And my kids said, oh, we have to get this. We have to get this for the guinea pig. And I said, well, I'm of the mind, it's good to let your kids make mistakes and learn from them when it's not going to, like, you know, you wait till adults, they can have to learn some hard lessons the hard way. So I said, well, are you willing to spend your own money? Oh, yes. Yes, we'll pay you back. once we get home, it's okay, we want the guinea pig dog. But guinea pigs do not jog. Under any circumstances, they're prey animals, so you know if the hawk is coming, they'll run because you can't walk a guinea pig. So Adam Hamilton, the book, he suggests that we try before we buy. Now he talks about with cars. He said, if you have a dream car, you think, boy, if I have this car, it's make me happy. He says, just rent one for a week and see, you know, because it might not be all that you think it's going to be after you've driven for a week. Good advice. What we should have done is borrow the neighbor's guinea pig jogging vest and put it on our guinea pig just to see that this thing would work. All right, so number three, develop a grateful heart. And this kind of alludes back to number one, think about things that you can be happy about, be grateful for in your life. Sometimes when we think about our kids, we'll think about, he does this or she doesn't do that, but what if we focused on good things that we're grateful for in our children? We love to go watch him play baseball, or we love to listen to her practice the piano, or we love how this one snuggles with their stuffed animals. We love the heart of compassion that we see in a child. Be grateful. The fourth thing, ask yourself, where does my soul find satisfaction? What truly satisfies? You're probably not going to come up with Snickers. The Bible points us again and again to God, that it's God, our Creator. God is the one who satisfies us. St. Augustine wrote this prayer, "You have formed us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you." You have formed us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. Powerful words to help treat a restless heart syndrome. Well, going hand in hand with cultivating contentment, the simpler our lives are, the more likely we are to be content with them. Complexity is the enemy of contentment. So, as a bonus, you're getting five ways that you might use to simplify your life. First of these, reduce your consumption. Choose to live below your means. Reduce your consumption. This kind of goes along with things we already talked about. Do I really need this thing or that thing? Or can I just as well do without? And once you decide you need something, you might consider, even if you can afford top of the line, just going with the medium grade of that item. Could be a better value than getting the very best. It's one way to reduce consumption. Simplify your life by asking before you buy, do I really need this? And why do I want this? One good piece of advice I heard is when you find yourself wanting something, write it down on a piece of paper, put the date on, and then don't buy it until 30 days have passed. See if you still want it. Because a lot of the things that we want, we only want for a moment. And 30 days goes by, you might be on to something else. And so you can just choose not to buy it. My family, a lot of people have Amazon Prime. We don't. And this is where you can get stuff shipped to you quickly, no shipping charges. You just pay $100 a year for this. But one of the things that's been demonstrated is that you buy more stuff if you have Amazon Prime. Because you can just click on it and boom, hey, here it comes. Like that, exactly. Well, if you don't have Amazon Prime, here's what you do. If you don't like to pay shipping, they don't like to pay shipping, so it's like usually $35, right, that you have to have purchased. So this means that Jill and I, when we come across things that we want, we'll put them in the wish list. And it's not so the whole world can find out what kind of junk we want. It's just so that we have it there, so that when we really do need something, well, we'll buy something else with it to make $35. Well, I have to laugh sometimes when I see what is on my wish list, and I'm thinking, what? Why did I want that thing? You know, I got to just kind of delete things out of that list. Once I found this in my wish list, this is a pair of ex officio, yes, give and go boxer brief. Oh, this is a nice product. Because when you work out or something, this like wicks the moisture from it. But you know, I looked at this after it'd been in there a while, I'm thinking, $17 for a pair of underwear? No way. I mean, it's still underwear, and it's not worth $17. So off the list. Off the list. Even if you're going to a store and you see, I'm trying to look at those things. Even if you're going to a store and you find a table 30% off, you go, oh, this is a great value. The sale ends today. You're tempted to buy it. You know, you're right there in the store. If you give yourself 24 hours, the odds are you're not even going to think of the thing, you know, the next day. And if you don't buy it, you will have saved not 30%, but 100%. Okay. Do I really need this? Why do I want this? Number three. Use something up before buying something new. And somebody gave me this quote. This was their mantra growing up. And somebody else was greeting me after the service said, yeah, my grew up in New England. We knew this too. So this is a gift from an 8 o'clock worshiper. Use it up, wear it out, make it do, or do without. That's pretty good stuff. You know, use something up before you buy something new. It's with household items, appliances, even automobiles. Just wait until you have exhausted the use of this thing. And if you do decide that, no, I'm going to replace this thing, and it still has useful life in it, hey, sell it to someone who can use it, or donate it to a nonprofit, or just to somebody that you know that would enjoy having it and use the rest of it up. If you're green, you know, reuse is the highest form of recycling. Jill, she is the expert on Craigslist. I am the eBay expert in our household. And you know, we have sold our stuff. Or we both know the drop-off points for the thrift stores. Give it away. Give it away. One of the purchases I made was about 7 years ago. It wasn't a have to, but it was just one of those things I decided I was going to do. I was tired of that, looking at that tube TV, and I was going to get a collapse screen. So that particular year, I'd been wanting this TV, and I got a sizable Christmas gift, cash Christmas gift. So I bought that TV, a beautiful, huge, 37 inches. Okay, not that huge. I still enjoy that TV today, by the way. But we had the old TV. What do we do with it? Well, we found an organization that would take it and use it, give it to somebody who could use it. So my guess is, even though that TV was 15 years old, you know, I couldn't get that thing to die. I would turn it on, off, on, off, on, and it still had life in it. But I bet somebody enjoyed that TV